sun that makes the day, that lights the way.
The aristocracy of Finney County had snubbed the trial. "It doesn't do," announced the wife of one rich rancher, "to seem curious about that sort of thing." Nevertheless, the trial's last session found a fair segment of the local establishment seated alongside the plainer citizenry. Their presence was a courteous gesture towards Judge Tate and Logan Green, esteemed members of their own order. Also a large contingent of out-of-town lawyers, many of whom had journeyed great distances, filled several benches. Specifically, they were on hand to hear Green's final address to the jury. Green, a suavely tough little septuagenarian, has an imposing reputation among his peers, who admire his stagecraft, a repertoire of actorish gifts that includes a sense of timing, acute as a nightclub comedian's. An expert criminal lawyer, his usual role is that of defender, but in this instance, the state had retained him as a special assistant to Duane West, for it was felt that the young county attorney was too unseasoned to prosecute the case without experienced support. But like most star turns, Green was the last act on the programme. Judge Tate's level-headed instructions to the jury preceded him, as did the county attorney's summation. "Can there be a single doubt in your minds regarding the guilt of these defendants? No. Regardless of who pulled the trigger on Richard Eugene Hickok's shotgun, both men are equally guilty. There is only one way to assure that these men will never again roam the towns and cities of this land. We request the maximum penalty, death. This request is made not in vengeance, but in all humbleness." Then the pleas of the defence attorneys had to be heard. Fleming's speech, described by one journalist as soft sell, amounted to a mild churchly sermon. "Man is not an animal. He has a body and he has a soul that lives forever. I don't believe man has the right to destroy that house, a temple in which the soul dwells." Harrison Smith, though he too appealed to the juror's presumed Christianity, took as his main theme the evils of capital punishment. "It is a relic of human barbarism. The law tells us that the taking of human life is wrong, then goes ahead and sets the example, which is almost as wicked as the crime it punished. The state has no right to inflict it. It isn't effective. It doesn't deter crime, but merely cheapens human life and gives rise to more murders. All we ask is mercy. Surely life imprisonment is small mercy to ask." Not everyone was attentive. One juror, as though poisoned by the numerous spring fever yawns waiting the air, sat with drugged eyes and jaws so utterly ajar bees could have buzzed in and out. Green woke them both up. "Gentlemen," he said, speaking without notes, "you have just heard two energetic pleas for mercy on behalf of the defendants. It seems to me fortunate that these admirable attorneys, Mr. Fleming and Mr. Smith, were not at the Clutterhouse that fateful night. Very fortunate for them that they were not present to plead mercy for the doomed family. Because had they been there, well, come next morning, we would have had more than four corpses to count." As a boy in his native Kentucky, Green was called Pinky, a nickname he owed to his freckled colouring. Now, as he strutted before the jury, the stress of his assignment warmed his face and splotched it with patches of pink. "I have no intention of engaging in theological debate, but I anticipated that defence counsel would use the Holy Bible as an argument against the death penalty. You have heard the Bible quoted, but I can read too." He slapped open a copy of the Old Testament. "And here are a few things the good book has to say on the subject. In Exodus 20, verse 13, we have one of the Ten Commandments, "Thou shalt not kill." This refers to unlawful killing. Of course it does, because in the next chapter, verse 12, the penalty for disobedience of that commandment reads, "He that smiteth the man so that he die shall surely be put to death." Now, Mr. Fleming would have you believe that all this was changed by the coming of Christ. Not so, for Christ says, "Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill." And finally, Green fumbled and seemed to accidentally shut the Bible, whereupon the visiting legal dignitaries grinned and nudged each other, because this was a venerable courtroom ploy. The lawyer, who while reading from the scriptures pretends to lose his place, and then remarks, as Green now did, "Never mind, I think I can quote from memory. Genesis 9, verse 6, "Whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed." "But," Green went on, "I see nothing to be gained by arguing the Bible. Our state provides that the punishment for murder in the first degree shall be imprisonment for life or death by hanging. That is the law. You, gentlemen, are here to enforce it. And if ever there was a case in which the maximum penalty was justified, this is it." These were strange, ferocious murders. Four of your fellow citizens were slaughtered like hogs in a pen. And for what reason? Not out of vengeance or hatred, but for money. Money! It was the cold and calculated weighing of so many ounces of silver against so many ounces of blood. And how cheaply those lives were bought. For $40 worth of loot. $10 a life. He whirled and pointed a finger that moved back and forth between Hickok and Smith. They went armed with a shotgun and a dagger. They went to rob and kill. His voice trembled, toppled, disappeared, as though strangled by the intensity of his own loathing for the debonair gum-chewing defendants. Turning again to the jury, he hoarsely asked, "What are you going to do? What are you going to do with these men that bind a man hand and foot and cut his throat and blow out his brains? Give them the minimum penalty? Yes, that's only one of four counts. What about Kenyon Clutter? A young boy with his whole life before him, tied helplessly in sight of his father's death struggle. Or young Nancy Clutter, hearing the gunshots and knowing her time was next. Nancy begging for her life. Don't, oh please, don't, please, please. What agony. What unspeakable torture. And there remains the mother, bound and gagged and having to listen as her husband, her beloved children, died one by one. Listen until at last the killers, these defendants before you, entered her room, focused a flashlight in her eyes, and let the blast of a shotgun end the existence of an entire household." Pausing, Green gingerly touched a boil on the back of his neck, a mature inflammation that seemed like its angry wearer about to burst. "So, gentlemen, what are you going to do? Give them the minimum? Send them back to the penitentiary, take the chance of their escaping or being paroled? The next time they go slaughtering, it may be your family. I say to you," he solemnly said, staring at the panel in a manner that encompassed and challenged them all, "some of our enormous crimes only happen because once upon a time a pack of chicken-hearted jurors refused to do their duty. Now, gentlemen, I leave it to you and your consciences." He sat down. West whispered to him, "Oh, that was masterly, sir." But a few of Green's auditors were less enthusiastic, and after the jury retired to discuss the verdict, one of them, a young reporter from Oklahoma, exchanged sharp words with another newsman, Richard Parr of the Kansas City Star. To the Oklahoman, Green's address had seemed rabble-rousing, brutal. He was just telling the truth, Parr said. The truth can be brutal, to coin a phrase. But he didn't have to hit that hard. It's unfair. What's unfair? The whole trial. These guys don't stand a chance. Fat chance they gave Nancy Clutter. Perry Smith, my God, he's had such a rotten life. Parr said, many a man can match sob stories with that little bastard, me included. Maybe I drink too much, but I sure as hell never killed four people in cold blood. Yeah, and how about hanging the bastard? That's pretty goddamn cold-blooded too. The Reverend Post, overhearing the conversation, joined in. Well, he said, passing around a snapshot reproduction of Perry Smith's portrait of Jesus, any man who could paint this picture can't be 100% bad. All the same, it's hard to know what to do. Capital punishment is no answer. It doesn't give the sinner time enough to come to God. Sometimes I despair. A jovial fellow with gold-filled teeth and a silvery widow's peak, he jovially repeated, sometimes I despair. Sometimes I think old Doc Savage had the right idea. The Doc Savage to whom he referred was a fictional hero popular among adolescent readers of pulp magazines a generation ago. If you boys remember, Doc Savage was a kind of Superman. He'd made himself proficient in every field, medicine, science, philosophy, art. There wasn't much old Doc didn't know or couldn't do. One of his projects was, he decided, to rid the world of criminals. First he bought a big island out in the ocean. Then he and his assistants, he had an army of trained assistants, kidnapped all the world's criminals and brought them to the island. And Doc Savage operated on their brains. He removed the part that holds wicked thoughts. And when they recovered, they were all decent citizens. They couldn't commit crimes because that part of their brain was out. Now it strikes me that surgery of this nature might really be the answer to... And a bell rang, the signal that the jury was returning. Interrupted him. The jury's deliberations had lasted 40 minutes. Many spectators, anticipating a swift decision, had never left their seats. Judge Tate, however, had to be fetched from his farm, where he'd gone to feed his horses. A hurriedly donned black robe billowed about him when he arrived, but it was with impressive sedateness and dignity that he asked, "Gentlemen of the jury, have you reached your verdict?" Their foreman replied, "We have, Your Honour." The court bailiff carried the sealed verdicts to the bench. Train whistles, the fanfare of an approaching Santa Fe Express penetrating the courtroom. Tate's bass voice interlaced with the locomotive's cries as he read, "Count one. We, the jury, find the defendant, Richard Eugene Hickok, guilty of murder in the first degree, and the punishment is death." Then, as though interested in their reaction, he looked down upon the prisoners, who stood before him handcuffed to guards. They stared back impassively until he resumed and read the seven counts that followed, 3 more convictions for Hickok and 4 for Smith. "And the punishment is death." Each time he came to the sentence, Tate enunciated with a dark-toned hollowness that seemed to echo the train's mournful, now fading call. Then he dismissed the jury. "You have performed a courageous service." And the condemned men were led away. At the door, Smith said to Hickok, "No chicken-hearted jurors, they!" They both laughed loudly, and the cameraman photographed them. The picture appeared in the Kansas paper above a caption entitled, "The Last Laugh." A week later, Mrs. Meyer was sitting in her parlour, talking to a friend. "Yes, it's turned quiet around here," she said. "I guess we ought to be grateful things have settled down, but I still feel bad about it. I never had much truck with Dick, but Perry and I got to know each other real well. That afternoon, after he heard the verdict and they brought him back up here, I shut myself in the kitchen to keep from having to see him. I sat by the kitchen window and watched the crowd leaving the courthouse. Mr. Cullivan, he looked up and saw me and waved. the Hickoks, all going away. Just this morning I had a lovely letter from Mrs. Hickok. She visited me several times while the trial was going on, and I wished I could have helped her. Only what can you say to someone in a situation like that? But after everybody had gone, and I had started to wash some dishes, I heard him crying. I turned on the radio, not to hear him, but I could, crying like a child. He'd never broke down before, shown any sign of it. Well, I went to him, the door of his cell. He reached out his hand. He wanted me to hold his hand. He wanted, and I did. I held his hand, and all he said was, "I'm embraced by shame." I wanted to send for Father Gorbio. I said first thing tomorrow I'd make him Spanish rice. But he just held my hand tighter. And that night, of all nights, we had to leave him alone. Wendell and I almost never go out, but we had a long-standing engagement and Wendell didn't think we ought to break it. But I'll always be sorry we left him alone. Next day I did fix the rice. He wouldn't touch it, or hardly speak to me. He hated the whole world. But the morning the men came to take him to the penitentiary, he thanked me and gave me a picture of himself, a little Kodak made when he was 16 years old. He said it was how he wanted me to remember him, like the boy in the picture. The bad part was saying goodbye. When you knew where he was going and what would happen to him, that squirrel of his, he sure misses Perry, keeps coming to the cell looking for him. I've tried to feed him, but he won't have anything to do with me. It was just Perry he liked. Prisons are important to the economy of Leavenworth County, Kansas. The two state penitentiaries, one for each sex, are situated there, and so is Leavenworth, the largest federal prison. And at Fort Leavenworth, the country's principal military prison, the grim United States Army and Air Force disciplinary barracks. If all the inmates in these institutions were let free, they could populate a small city. The oldest of the prisons is the Kansas State Penitentiary for Men, a turreted black and white palace that visually distinguishes an otherwise ordinary rural town. Lansing. Built during the Civil War, it received its first resident in 1864. Nowadays, the convict population averages around 2,000. The present warden, Sherman H. Krause, keeps a chart which lists the daily total according to race. For example, white, 1,405, coloured, 360, Mexicans, 12, Indians, 6. Whatever his race, each convict is a citizen of a stony village that exists within the prison's steep machine-gun-guarded walls, 12 grey acres of cement streets and cell blocks and workshops. In a south section of the prison compound, there stands a curious little building, a dark, two-storied building shaped like a coffin. This establishment, officially called the Segregation and Isolation Building, constitutes a prison inside a prison. Among the inmates, the lower floor is known as the Hole, the place to which difficult prisoners, the hard rock troublemakers, are now and then banished. The upper story is reached by climbing a circular iron staircase. At the top is Death Row. The first time the clutter murderers ascended the staircase was late one rainy April afternoon. Having arrived at Lansing after an 8-hour, 400-mile car ride from Garden City, the newcomers had been stripped, showered, given close haircuts, and supplied with coarse denim uniforms and soft slippers. In most American prisons, such slippers are a condemned man's customary footwear. Then armed escorts march them through a wet twilight to the coffin-shaped edifice, hustle them up the spiral staircase and into two of the 12 side-by-side cells that comprise Lansing's Death Row. The cells are identical. They measure 7 by 10 feet and are unfurnished except for a cot, a toilet, a basin and an overhead light bulb that is never extinguished night or day. The cell windows are very narrow and not only barred but covered with a wire mesh black as a widow's veil. Thus the faces of those sentenced to hang can be but hazily discerned by passers-by. The doomed themselves can see out well enough, and what they see is an empty dirt lot that serves in summer as a baseball diamond. Beyond the lot, a piece of prison wall, and above that, a piece of sky. The wall is made of rough stone. Pigeons nest inside its crevices. A rusty iron door set into the part of the wall visible to the row's occupants rouses the pigeons whenever it's opened, puts them in a flap, for the hinges creak so they scream. The door leads into a cavernous storage room, where on even the warmest day the air is moist and chilly. A number of things are kept there. Stockpiles of metal used by the convicts to manufacture automobile license plates, lumber, old machinery, baseball paraphernalia, and also an unpainted wooden gallows that smells faintly of pine. For this is the state's execution chamber. When a man is brought here to be hanged, the prisoners say he has gone to the corner, or alternatively, paid a visit to the warehouse. In accordance with the sentence of the court, Smith and Hickok were scheduled to visit the warehouse 6 weeks hence, at 1 minute after midnight on Friday, May 13th, 1960. Kansas abolished capital punishment in 1907. In 1935, due to a sudden prevalence in the Midwest of rampaging professional criminals, Alvin, Old Creepy Carpus, Charles, Pretty Boy Floyd, Clyde Barrow and his homicidal sweetheart, Bonnie Parker, Bonnie and Clyde, the state legislators voted to restore it. However, it was not until 1944 that an executioner had a chance to employ his craft. Over the next 10 years, he was given 9 additional opportunities. But for 6 years, or since 1954, there had been no paychecks for a hangman in Kansas, except at the Army and Air Force disciplinary barracks, which also has a gallows. The late George Docking, governor of Kansas from 1957 through 1960, was responsible for this hiatus, for he was unreservedly opposed to the death penalty. "I just don't like killing people." Now, at that time, April 1960, there were in United States prisons 190 persons awaiting civil execution. 5, the clutter killers included, were among the lodgers at Lansing. Occasionally, important visitors to the prison are invited to take what one high official calls a little peek at death row. Those who accept are assigned a guard who, as he leads the tourist along the iron walkway fronting the death cells, is likely to identify the condemned with what he must consider comic formality. "And this," he said to a visitor in 1960, "is Mr. Perry Edward Smith. Now next door, that's Mr. Smith's buddy, Mr. Richard Eugene Hickok. And over here we have Mr. Earl Wilson, and after Mr. Wilson, meet Mr. Bobby Joe Spencer. And for this last gentleman, I'm sure you recognise the famous Mr. Lowell Lee Andrews." Earl Wilson, a husky, hymn-singing Negro, had been sentenced to die for the kidnapping, rape and torture of a young white woman. The victim, though she survived, was left severely disabled. Bobby Joe Spencer, white, an effeminate youth, had confessed to murdering an elderly Kansas City woman, the owner of a rooming house where he lived. Prior to leaving office in January 1961, Governor Docking, who had been defeated for re-election, in large measure because of his attitude towards capital punishment, commuted the sentences of both these men to life imprisonment, which generally meant that they could apply for parole in 7 years. However, Bobby Joe Spencer soon killed again, stabbed with a shiv another young convict, his rival for the affections of an older inmate. As one prison officer said, "Just two punks fighting over a jocker." This deed earned Spencer a second life sentence, but the public was not much aware of either Wilson or Spencer, compared to Smith and Hickok, or the fifth man on the row, Lowell Lee Andrews. The press had rather slighted them. 2 years earlier, Lowell Lee Andrews, an enormous, weak-eyed boy of 18 who wore horn-rimmed glasses and weighed almost 300 pounds, had been a sophomore at the University of Kansas, an honor student, majoring in biology. Though he was a solitary creature, withdrawn and seldom communicative, his acquaintances, both at the university and in his hometown of Walcott, Kansas, regarded him as exceptionally gentle and sweet-natured. Later, one Kansas paper printed an article about him entitled "The Nicest Boy in Walcott." But inside the quiet young scholar there existed a second, unsuspected personality, one with stunted emotions and a distorted mind through which cold thoughts flowed in cruel directions. His family, his parents and a slightly older sister, Jenny Marie, would have been astounded had they known the daydreams Lowell Lee dreamed throughout the summer and autumn of 1958. The brilliant son, the adored brother, was planning to poison them all. The elder Andrews was a prosperous farmer. He had not much money in the bank, but he owned land valued at approximately $200,000. A desire to inherit this estate was ostensibly the motivation behind Lowell Lee's plot to destroy his family. For the secret Lowell Lee, the one concealed inside the shy, church-going biology student, fancied himself an ice-hearted master criminal. He wanted to wear gangsterish silk shirts, drive scarlet sports cars. He wanted to be recognised as no mere bespectable, bookish, overweight, virginal schoolboy, and while he did not dislike any members of his family, at least not consciously, murdering them seemed the swiftest, most sensible way of implementing the fantasies that possessed him. Arsenic was the weapon he decided upon. After poisoning the victims, he meant to tuck them in their beds and burn down the house, in the hope that investigators would believe the deaths accidental. However, one detail perturbed him. Suppose autopsies revealed the presence of arsenic, and suppose the purchase of the poison could be traced to him. Toward the end of the summer, he evolved another plan. He spent 3 months polishing it. Finally, there came a near-zero November night when he was ready to act. It was Thanksgiving week, and Lowell Lee was home for the holidays, as was Jenny Marie, an intelligent but rather plain girl who attended a college in Oklahoma. One evening of November 28th, somewhere around 7, Jenny Marie was sitting with her parents in the parlour watching television. Lowell Lee was locked in his bedroom, reading the last chapter of The Brothers Karamazov. That task completed, he shaved, changed into his best suit, and proceeded to load both a semi-automatic 22 caliber rifle and a Ruger 22 caliber revolver. He fitted the revolver into a hip holster, shouldered the rifle, and ambled down a hall to the parlour, which was dark except for the flickering television screen. He switched on a light, aimed the rifle, pulled the trigger, and hit his sister between the eyes, killing her instantly. He shot his mother 3 times and his father 2 times. The mother, eyes gaping, arms outstretched, staggered towards him. She tried to speak, her mouth opened, closed, but Lowell Lee said, "Shut up!" To be certain she obeyed him, he shot her 3 times more. Mr. Andrews, however, was still alive. Sobbing, whimpering, he thrashed along the floor towards the kitchen. But at the kitchen's threshold, the son unholstered his revolver and discharged every chamber, then reloaded the weapon and emptied it again. Altogether, his father absorbed 17 bullets. Andrews, according to statements credited to him, didn't feel anything about it. The time came, and I was doing what I had to do. That's all there was to it. After the shootings, he raised a window in his bedroom and removed the screen, then roamed the house, rifling dresser drawers and scattering the contents. It was his intention to blame the crime on thieves. Later, driving his father's car, he travelled 40 miles over snow-slippery roads to Lawrence, the town where the University of Kansas is located. En route, he parked on a bridge, dismantled his lethal artillery, and disposed of it by dropping the parts into the Kansas River. But of course the journey's true purpose was to arrange an alibi. First he stopped at the campus house where he roomed. He talked with the landlady, told he'd come to pick up his typewriter, and that, because of the bad weather, the trip from Walcott to Lawrence had taken him 2 hours. Departing, he visited a movie theatre where, uncharacteristically, he chatted with the usher and a candy vendor. At 11, when the movie let out, he returned to Walcott. The family's mongrel dog was waiting on the front porch. It was whining with hunger. So Lowell Lee, entering the house and stepping across his father's corpse, prepared a bowl of warm milk and mush. Then, while the dog was lapping it up, he telephoned the sheriff's office and said, "My name is Lowell Lee Andrews. I live at 6040 Walcott Drive, and I want to report a robbery." 4 officers of the Wyandotte County Sheriff's Patrol responded. One of the group, Patrolman Mayers, described the scene as follows. "Well, it was 1 a.m. when we got there. All the lights in the house was on, and this big dark-haired boy, Lowell Lee, he was sitting on the porch petting his dog, patting it on the head. Lieutenant Athey asked the boy what happened, and he pointed to the door, real casual, and said, 'Look in there.' Having looked, the astonished officer summoned the county coroner, a gentleman who was also impressed by young Andrew's callous nonchalance. But when the coroner asked him what funeral arrangements he wished to have made, Andrews replied with a shrug, 'I don't care what you do with them.' Shortly, 2 senior detectives appeared and began to question the family's lone survivor. Though convinced he was lying, the detectives listened respectfully to the tale of how he had driven to Lawrence to fetch a typewriter, gone to a movie, and arrived home after midnight to find the bedrooms ransacked and his family slain. He stayed with the story and might never have altered it if, subsequent to his arrest and removal to the county jail, the authorities had not obtained the aid of Reverend Mr. Verto C. Dameron." The Reverend Dameron, a Dickensian personage, an unctuous and jolly brimstone and damnation orator, was minister of the Grand View Baptist Church in Kansas City, Kansas, the church the Andrews family attended regularly. Awakened by an urgent call from the county coroner, Dameron presented himself at the jail around 3 a.m., whereupon detectives, who had been strenuously but abortively interrogating the suspect, withdrew to another room, leaving the minister to consult privately with his parishioner. It proved a fatal interview for the latter, who many months afterward gave this account of it to a friend. "Mr. Dameron said, 'Now, Lee, I've known you all your life, since you were just a little tadpole. And I knew your daddy all his life. We grew up together. We were childhood friends. And that's why I'm here. Not just because I'm your minister, but because I feel like you're a member of my own family. And because you need a friend that you can talk to and trust. And I feel terrible about the terrible event, and I'm every bit as anxious as you are to see the guilty party caught and punished.' He wanted to know, was I thirsty? And I was, so he got me a Coke. And after that, he's going on about the Thanksgiving vacation and how do I like the school, when all of a sudden he says, 'Now, Lee, there seems to be some doubt among the people here regarding your innocence. I'm sure you'd be willing to take a lie detector and convince these men of your innocence so they can get busy and catch the guilty party.' And then he said, 'Lee, you didn't do this terrible thing, did you? If you did, now's the time to purge your soul.' Next thing was, I thought what difference it make, and I told him the truth, most everything about it. He kept wagging his head and rolling his eyes and rubbing his hands together, and he said it was a terrible thing, and I'd have to answer to the Almighty, have to purge my soul by telling the officers what I'd told him, and would I?" Receiving an affirmative nod, the prisoner's spiritual adviser stepped into an adjacent room which was crowded with expectant policemen, and elatedly issued an invitation. "Come on in! The boy's ready to make a statement!" The Andrews case became the basis for a legal and medical crusade. Prior to the trial, at which Andrews pleaded innocent by reason of insanity, the psychiatric staff of the Menninger Clinic conducted an exhaustive examination of the accused. This produced a diagnosis of schizophrenia simple type. By simple, the diagnosticians meant that Andrews suffered no delusions, no false perceptions, no hallucinations, but the primary illness of separation of thinking from feeling. He understood the nature of his acts, and that they were prohibited, and that he was subject to punishment. But, to quote Dr. Joseph Satin, one of the examiners, "Lowell Lee Andrews felt no emotions whatsoever. He considered himself the only important, only significant person in the world. And in his own seclusive world, it seemed to him just as right to kill his mother as to kill an animal or a fly." In the opinion of Dr. Satin and his colleagues, Andrews' crime amounted to such an undebatable example of diminished responsibility that the case offered an ideal chance to challenge the McNaughton rule in Kansas courts. The McNaughton rule, as has been previously stated, recognises no form of insanity provided the defendant has the capacity to discriminate between right and wrong, legally, not morally. Much to the distress of psychiatrists and liberal jurists, the rule prevails in the courts of the British Commonwealth and in the United States, in the courts of all but half a dozen or so of the states and the District of Columbia, which abide by the more lenient, though to some minds impractical, Durham rule, which is simply that an accused is not criminally responsible if his unlawful act is the product of mental disease or mental defect. In short, what Andrews' defenders, a team composed of Menninger Clinic psychiatrists and two first-class attorneys, hoped to achieve was a victory of legal landmark stature. The great essential was to persuade the court to substitute the Durham rule for the McNaughton rule. If that happened, then Andrews, because of the abundant evidence concerning his schizophrenic condition, would certainly not be sentenced, or he'd certainly be sentenced not to the gallows or even to prison, but to confinement in the state hospital for the criminally insane. However, the defence reckoned without the defendant's religious counsellor, the tireless Reverend Mr. Dameron, who appeared at the trial as the chief witness for the prosecution, and who, in the overwrought rococo style of a tent show revivalist, told the court he had often warned his former Sunday school pupil of God's impending wrath. "I says, there isn't anything in this world that is worth more than your soul, and you have acknowledged to me a number of times in our conversations that your faith is weak, and that you have no faith in God. You know that all sin is against God, and God is your final judge, and you have got to answer to him. That is what I said to make him feel the terribleness of the thing he had done, and that he had to answer to the Almighty for this crime." Apparently the Reverend Dameron was determined young Andrews should answer not only to the Almighty, but also to more temporal powers, for it was his testimony, added to the defendant's confession, that settled matters. The presiding judge upheld the McNaughton rule, and the jury gave the state the death penalty it demanded. Friday, May 13th, the first date set for the execution of Smith and Hickok, passed harmlessly, the Kansas Supreme Court having granted them a stay pending the outcome of appeals for a new trial filed by their lawyers. At that time, the Andrews verdict was under review by the same court. Perry's cell adjoined Dick's. Though invisible to each other, they could easily converse, yet Perry seldom spoke to Dick, and it wasn't because of any declared animosity between them. After the exchange of a few tepid reproaches, their relationship had turned into one of mutual toleration, the acceptance of uncongenial but helpless Siamese twins. It was because Perry, cautious as always, secretive, suspicious, disliked having the guards and other inmates overhear his private business, especially Andrews, or Andy as he was called on the row. Andrews' educated accent and the formal quality of his college-trained intelligence were anathema to Perry, who, though he had not gone beyond third grade, imagined himself more learned than most of his acquaintances, and he enjoyed correcting them, especially their grammar and pronunciation. But here suddenly was someone, just a kid, constantly correcting him. Was it any wonder he never opened his mouth? Better to keep your mouth shut than to risk one of the college kids' snotty lines like, "Don't say disinterested when what you mean is uninterested." Andrews meant well, he was without malice, but Perry could have boiled him in oil. Yet he never admitted it, never let anyone there guess why. After one of these humiliating incidents, he sat and sulked and ignored the meals that were delivered to him 3 times a day. At the beginning of June, he stopped eating altogether. He told Dick, "You can't wait around for the rope. You can wait around for the rope, but not me." And from that moment, he refused to touch food or water or say one word to anybody. The fast lasted 5 days before the warden took it seriously. On the 6th day, he ordered Smith transferred to the prison hospital, but the move did not lessen Perry's resolve. When attempts were made to force feed him, he fought back, tossed his head, clenched his jaws until they were rigid as horseshoes. Eventually, he had to be pinioned and fed intravenously or through a tube inserted in a nostril. Even so, over the next 9 weeks, his weight fell from 168 to 115 pounds, and the warden was warned that force-feeding alone could not keep the patient alive indefinitely. Dick, though impressed by Perry's willpower, would not concede that his purpose was suicide. Even when Perry was reported to be in a coma, he told Andrews, with whom he had become friendly, that his former confederate was faking. "He just wants them to think he's crazy." Andrews, a compulsive eater, he'd filled a scrapbook with illustrated edibles, everything from strawberry shortcake to roasted pig, said, "Oh, maybe he is crazy, starving himself like that. He just wants to get out of here, play acting, so they'll say he's crazy and put him in the crazy house." Dick afterward grew fond of quoting Andrew's reply, for it seemed to him a fine specimen of the boy's funny thinking, his off-on-a-cloud complacency. "Well," Andrews allegedly said, "it sure strikes me a hard way to do it, starving yourself, because sooner or later we'll all get out of here, either walk out or be carried out in a coffin. Myself, I don't care whether I walk or get carried. It's all the same in the end." Dick said, "The trouble with you, Andy, you've got no respect for human life, including your own." Andrews agreed. "And," he said, "I'll tell you something else. If ever I do get out of here alive, I mean over the walls and clear out, well, maybe nobody will know where Andy went, but they'll sure hell know where Andy's been." All summer, Perry undulated between half-awake stupors and sickly, sweat-drenched sleep. Voices roared in his head. One voice persistently asked him, "Where's Jesus? Where?" And once he woke up shouting, "The bird is Jesus! The bird is Jesus!" His favourite old theatrical fantasy, the one in which he thought of himself as Perry O'Parsons, the one-man symphony, returned in the guise of a recurrent dream. The dream's geographical centre was a Las Vegas nightclub, where, wearing a white top hat and a white tuxedo, he strutted about a spotlighted stage, playing in turn a harmonica, a guitar, a banjo, drums, sang "You Are My Sunshine," and tap-danced up a short flight of gold-painted prop steps. At the top, standing on a platform, he took a bow. There's no applause, none, and yet thousands of patrons packed the vast and gaudy room. A strange audience, mostly men and mostly Negroes. Staring at them, the perspiring entertainer at last understood their silence, for suddenly he knew that they were phantoms, the ghosts of the legally annihilated, the hanged, the gassed, the electrocuted. And in the same instant he realised that he was there to join them, that the gold-painted steps had led to a scaffold, that the platform on which he stood was opening beneath him. His top hat tumbled, urinating, defecating, Perio Parsons entered eternity. One afternoon he escaped from a dream and wakened to find the warden standing beside his bed. The warden said, "Sounds like you were having a little nightmare." But Perry wouldn't answer him. And the warden, who on several occasions had visited the hospital and tried to persuade the prisoner to cease his fast, said, "I have something here from your father. I thought you might want to see it." Perry, his eyes glitteringly immense in a face now almost phosphorescently pale, studied the ceiling, and presently, after placing a picture postcard on the patient's bedside table, the rebuffed visitor departed. That night, Perry looked at the card. It was addressed to the warden and postmarked Blue Lake, California. The message, written in a familiar stubby script, said, "Dear sir, I understand you have my boy Perry back in custody. Write me, please, what did he do wrong? And if I come there, could I see him? All's well with me, and trust the same with you. Tex J. Smith." Perry destroyed the card, but his mind preserved it, for the few crude words had resurrected him emotionally, revived love and hate, and reminded him that he was still what he had tried not to be, alive. "And I just decided," he later informed a friend, "that I ought to stay that way. Anybody wanted my life wasn't going to get any more help from me. They'd have to fight for it." The next morning, he asked for a glass of milk, the first sustenance he had volunteered to accept in 14 weeks. Gradually, on a diet of eggnogs and orange juice, he regained weight. By October, the prison physician, Dr. Robert Moore, considered him strong enough to be returned to the row. When he arrived there, Dick laughed and said, "Welcome home, honey!"
The day that lights the way.